Most people in life are looking for, how do I make a life worth living in and a retirement worth having? And when I'm sitting here literally in the rain, huddled underneath a jacket to keep my equipment from getting wet and ruined by electronics and how electricity and water just doesn't mix, I have to be marveled at the fact that the Lord God above is always with us. And when He's always with us and always in our soul, we're always thinking about, how am I doing in front of the Lord? It's my constant question. After I spend a little time with any child of God, any regardless of their age, who comes up to talk with me, I'm always double-checking with God afterwards. It's kind of like a military debrief. And that debrief I'm able to do because, well, I have some Wiccan ways, and I have some pagan ways, and I have some Christian ways. And openly, I really listen, and I meditate, and I hear the Lord. But in life, we have moments of time to talk to people about what's going on in their life. What most people are sort of marveled at with me is that I pretty much nail them to the wall. What I mean by that is I just start listening to the Lord speaking to them through me. Now, most people don't even believe in God anymore, and that's really a shame, because God is this amazing educator, this amazing trainer, this amazing master, this amazing wisdom source that we can plug into at any time. But the only way that I received my gifts and the gifts that I have now is because I just kept submitting over and over and over and again to the Lord. That I am not wise enough to be smart enough to be over people, that I'm not good enough as a man to be a leader is not true, but openly I lead better when I'm caring about the people who I, well, have to lead. And in life, if I don't care about the students that I'm training, then I can't possibly teach them. So in one of my businesses that was highly about training people and educating people in foreign cultures, we had an assessment. And that assessment established whether or not that potential client, that possible student, could actually be our full-time student. If they didn't make it through the assessment, which had about 5 different stages and steps to it, then we weren't interested in having them in as a student. Because we pretty much got down the exact clientele, the exact demographics that we needed in order to, well, have them for a client beyond just a 3-month entertainment period or a 6-month, well, evaluation period and beyond the year, because our contracts were actually annual. At the end of usually every student's journey with our program, almost every single one, except for a few women in their, well, matronly ways, would actually want to hug me or my spouse and thank us for our kindness, our love, our food, and the fact that we serve food in typical environment, not only for the Japanese culture, but also in our own home and family environment. We would do that in hospitality. But openly, they would thank us for the education that they got beyond what they were paying for. And I was always marveled at that because I never really thought about that when I was interacting with them. But in life, we have moments of time to tell people what is real about the world. And when I am educating someone who's below the age of, say, 20 or 21, it is my responsibility as an educator and a mentor to make sure people are thinking clearly about what happens in the real world. I'm always amazed to see a young man who I had a kind of a tit-for-tat from with once during the late stages of losing my wife. And he was just mouthing off, and I just put him to the quick, and I said, listen, little man, you might have a marvelous home. You might have an incredible dad. You might have a fabulously, incredibly technologically advanced mom. But here's the reality. If you don't learn how to get along with people, if you don't learn how to listen to others, you will never be anything in the world. Within that phase, he really kind of righted himself. It was almost as though he could feel the Lord saying, look, you monkeyed yourself here. Let's apologize, let's make up, let's go on. And that was an incredible maturity for a young man to do. Most of my kids were pretty good huggers when they left. Others were more handshakers, or their parents would come in. But the truth is, in life, a mentor knows what people need. And as an old man, I can look at the young men on campus, particularly the white men, since I'm of that Caucasianness, and say, this is what you need, little man. But they don't really want to listen to me because they see that I'm homeless. But they have no content about who I am, where I came from, what I've accomplished, how many books I've written, or what things I've done for my own professional community of which I came from. You see, they have no video reference for my life. And I, of course, have very little about their life except what I see as an old man, probably old enough practically to be almost their father's age, or better. The truth is, with age comes wisdom is an old adage in almost every culture, probably practically, of the world, and I've studied mainly East Asia and Americas. But in life, if we don't recognize some of the standards of our communities, the social concepts and nuances of, well, the things that put people at ease, then we monkey it and we get stuck in, well, retailville or hell or whatever the hell we want to call a life that's less fulfilled. If your life is not fulfilling, if you're not making the income that you'd like to, like I am at this point, not making quite what I'm accustomed to and certainly not making what I'd like to, I still had to come and succumb and succeed in a way that makes me feel okay. So even though I'm homeless, I can still put my mind and my heart and my soul at peace because I know that the Lord has a plan for me through this, that there's something I'm supposed to do from the education experience of this, and that openly I know that my political career is about to launch in a way that will probably marvel a lot of people. But the truth is I'm practically a marketing person. I am accustomed to marketing people, programs, politics, and, well, products. And I might not get it in the right order every single time I say my own mantras and my own taglines, but it's what I do. And making moments matter is something that's really important to me. It might be important to you because truly at the late stages of our life, we're not going to care what we've got. We can't take it with us. We all know. But truly who's around us in those moments of time when we can't blow our nose or wipe our ass is sort of important. I'm always amazed at the people who literally learn very little about love in life. My late father was sort of a monster in my early years as a child, but he became a magnificent man in his seasoned years of 60, 70, and above. He was very loving and incredibly kind and always thoughtful and never really rough with us anymore. He recognized his balance between being a father and being a brother and being a friend to us all. I am very fortunate that my father loved me as much as he did. I'm very fortunate that things he's taught me, and I wish I'd done things more as a kid. But the truth is, in life, we have moments of time to really learn what love is. And I know that as my late father was starting to die from his 80s on until, well, just 4 days shy of his 85th birthday, that the only person in life that he wanted to see was his actual wife. He, of course, enjoyed seeing most of his children that came around who were willing to show up every now and again, like me, who was driving my mother over because it was safer for her and better for me, even though I had hated their car. But that's not important. The truth is that in life, we have moments of time to know what is right. And my father loved my mother, his wife, for, well, 63 years. So that's pretty amazing to me that they were married for that long. I know what love is, I know what challenges are, and the strife and the struggle of poverty and of middle wages and middle stages, and what do they call that kind of middle wage life. But openly in life, the most important thing, the most important person that we'll ever have as a man in this lifetime is the right wife. When you choose the wrong life partner, you are miserable for a long time. They will lie, they will steal, they will cheat you away from your life. And if you choose someone who is into vanity, they will monkey your face, ruin your skin, and destroy every part of your soul that the Lord God placed within. In life, we have moments of time to tell people what matters, and I can tell you the most important thing to me, regardless of how many millions I might come to make with all the ideas and intellectual property that God has gifted me to date, that the most important people to me still remain is my life partner, my lover, and practically my Japanese spouse and son. So at this time, I can talk about the truth of the Bible, the truth of the Quran, and the truth of any kind of works from Confucius or Mencius or Lao Tzu that literally talk about the life of a man. But the life of a man will partner with someone and leave his mother and father's house and go on to produce his own family, his own friends network, his own business network, and remarkably, his own network of men. In my life, I hosted, even in the late stages when I was starting to lose my business because of the downturn in the economy and all the things going on for me with the late stages of my father's Parkinson's PSP, as I was still leading a Bible group, a Bible study in my classroom. And it was sort of hard for me because the men would show up and never bring anything they were supposed to. And I was marveling at that because there was a guy walking around talking about gifting somebody $10,000. And I sat there and I looked at some of the other guys who were court clerks or little clerk of some post office, some podunk, who barely made enough living. And I just thought how an marvelment of how stupid that man sounded, how inappropriate his content was, and how foolish that I felt that I was providing all this food for people that I could barely eat for myself. In life, we have moments of time to show people who we are, but the bottom line is who we partner with in life, not only for a spouse or significant other, but also for business partners in life, make or break what our life will look like, the people we'll have around us, and the quality of life we have in our soul life, in our spiritual life with the Lord. Thanks practically for listening.